Vanchya kalpatarubhyascha kripa sindubhya evacha patitanam pavanibhyo vaishnavibhyo namo namaha. Hare Krishna. I'd like to welcome everybody who is joining us today for this discussion on a very important topic, the topic of reading Srila Prabhupada's books every day, its significance for our own personal spiritual life, and its importance for ISKCON. Today joining us is a very, very respectable personality who is an ISKCON GBC member, an initiating spiritual master, a disciple of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, and who's been part of this movement for as long as we can tell. I take great pleasure to invite His Holiness Devamrita Maharaj. Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Maharaj, thank you for joining us today. And in order to make the best of the little time we have together, I'd like to first ask you, what was your very first encounter with Srila Prabhupada's books?
During my university years, I would often come to New York City for so-called relief through entertainment, and I would wander in the Second Avenue area, right where Srila Prabhupada had his first center. And that was my favorite area in New York City, in Manhattan. I just had a feeling that there was something in that area for me. So while wandering in that area, I ran into a chanting party and they pushed a Back to Godhead magazine into my hands. I gave them 25 cents and I took the magazine with me to where I was going for entertainment, and I read it there and found it very interesting. It talked about love of God. I didn't see anything else, though, for the next 2 years, until right after I graduated. And this time I saw a book distributor on the street and I walked up to him and asked, "What do you have there?" And the book distributor looked like he was having a tough day and was very shocked that someone would walk up and ask, "What do you have?" So I bought a Transcendental Teachings of Prahlad Maharaj, which was in a booklet form. And I took that to where I was going and sat down and began to read. And by the time I arrived at page 2, I was completely devastated. Srila Prabhupada was repeating, paraphrasing the instructions of Prahlad Maharaj. And what really hit me was the verse, material happiness and material distress come their own way. You don't have to endeavor for either of them. So why waste your life chasing the same gratifications that are available in any species of life? When I read that, I collapsed. Literally, I collapsed on the couch where I was sitting and decided then and there to go into New York City to the, shall we say, bohemian section where there were many alternative bookstores. And I knew there I would find more books by this Swami whose name I couldn't pronounce. So there at the bookshop the next day, I bought Bhagavad Gita As It Is, Teachings of Lord Chaitanya. And that began my journey in Srila Prabhupada's books.
25 cents well spent. I'm reminded of the statement where I think it was Gaurakishwardas Babaji was approached. We want to know bhakti. And he says, go to the marketplace. And in one ana, he said, you can buy these two books. 25 cents, which gave love of Godhead. Those are the two statements I can keep in my mind. Oh, Maharaj, yeah. Maharaj, you mentioned it was Gaurakishore.
Yes, Gaurakishore, as Babaji said, you get Prema Bhakti Chandrika and Pratana Narottam Das Thakur. So I received that through Srila Prabhupada, through Parampara.
And Maharaj, which year was this? You said it was interspread with 2 years from the first Back to Godhead and the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj.
I finished university in May of 72, and the next month, June, when I was trying to decide what my future would be, there was so much pressure on me to enter the corporate world, because most of you may know, but some may not, the university system in the USA is very gauged according to elitism at the top. And so if you attend a super elitist institution, then it's almost required that you must enter into some top level of something. But I was thinking very deeply, what did I really want? So that was June of 72.
Well, it's one thing is for sure, Maharaj, that you did enter the top level of everything.
Goloka Kera Prema Dana Harinam Sankirtan.
So we really wish that all the Ivy School students follow in your footsteps and do the same when they graduate from the university in the US. Maharaj, your first encounter with Back to Godhead, you so nicely shared with us the second page and that paragraph where Srila Prabhupada describes that just like misery come of its own accord, happiness will too. Is there anything that you also recall from the Back to Godhead magazine, something that left an impression, wanted you to read more?
The pictures of Radha Krishna deities, I thought they were dolls, but I said there's something otherworldly about these dolls. I can't get them out of my mind.
Maharaj, so 1972, you started reading Srila Prabhupada's books. It seems like your most prominent, like some devotees say, they're influenced by the prasadam, some are influenced by the association of devotees, etc. But it seems that your spiritual life, the impetus was Srila Prabhupada's books. Did you manage to then maintain that same affection for Srila Prabhupada's books and reading them?
Well, when I went to the bookshop to get more of his books in June of 72, one thing I was sure of, I didn't want to associate with devotees. I thought that they were extremely exotic and were just not from the same world I was in. And I was very, in my mind, concerned with the problems of the world and how they could be solved. So I thought, these books are wonderful, but the people, I don't know, they're strange. So I decided to read the books in my own home, which I did for 3 to 4 hours a day, every day, for 6 months straight.
Ooh, that's something.
I ordered more books through the BBT mail order because I wanted nothing to do with devotees. So if I ordered through the post, then I wouldn't have to contact them. So this went on for 6 months straight. Reading, rereading, Nectar Devotion, Krishna book, Isha Upanishad. Then, in November of 72, I got a letter from BBT mail order saying that the first Western printed version of Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, was about to come out. And the brochure that I received in the mail described this first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam as the encyclopedia of the spiritual world. And it described how Srimad Bhagavatam took all the themes of Bhagavad Gita and expanded upon them. So I said, wow, this is extraordinary. More books. I've read everything everything I have twice, three times, 3 to 4 hours a day for 6 months straight. And now there's this, the Srimad Bhagavatam, the encyclopedia of the spiritual world, for the first time printed in the Western world. Because, you know, Srila Prabhupada, up to that point, just had his Delhi version, which was rustic looking. But this edition was the first one printed in the West, and it was going to be super deluxe, as the brochure said. So I had a problem. I couldn't wait 2 weeks to get it in the mail. I had to take a risk and approach a devotee. I knew where they were. They were always at one huge bus terminal in Manhattan in New York City. So I decided, I've got to seek them out, score these books, and then run away. So I went, and I saw one lady book distributor. Back then, the ladies who lived in the temple, if they were unmarried, they wore pink bed sheets. And if they were married, they wore yellow bed sheets. And everyone wore gray hoodies, gray hooded sweat tops and jackets. And so I got over my apprehension of approaching her. I walked past once, twice, three times to see if she would stop me. She didn't. So I was decked out in fashionable attire. And so I finally said, all right, I'm going to approach her. So I walked up to her and asked what I thought was an everyday normal question. I said, do you have Srimad Bhagavatam? And she froze for a moment, but then she's expert. Daivi Shakti Mataji, who's still in Vrindavan to this day, she caught herself and then just said, well, how do you know about that? I said, never mind. I'm just here to get the books. There's no need for us to talk. She wouldn't let me off the hook. How do you know so much? I said, really, believe me, I don't want to talk. Do you have the books or do you not? But she went on and on and switched the subject about how they're trying to get a new building in New York. And I look like someone who could help. And that I should give something in charity for the new building. I said, I've never given a penny of charity in my life, and I'm not about to start now. But she went on and on. Oh, it's going to be so wonderful, the building. It's going to have a theater, a library, a cafe, restaurant, meditation rooms, this, that, the other. It sounded interesting to me. Yeah, that sounds like a cool thing to do in New York City, but I just want the books right now. But she went on and on. Please, you can help. Give a donation. And then I told her, look, I'll leave it to you in my will. Or she tore that one to shreds. You know, what 21-year-old guy has a will back then, you know? So finally I said, anyway, even if I wanted to give you some money, all my money's at my father's house. She said, let's go. I couldn't get rid of her. She stuck to me like glue and escorted me on the subway in New York, 25-minute trip to where my father lived. And that was on the 14th floor. So I made sure she stayed down on the sidewalk because I didn't want to bring any strange-looking girl like that to to my father's place. So I came down with a check, which in today's dollar value was $5,000. I gave it to her. She looked at it and said, "This is very good, but I'd like 10. I said, "Oh no." I was speechless, but I couldn't convince her otherwise. And then I think the super soul tricked me. All around were these tall apartment buildings, and a voice inside me said, "Better give her what she wants, because right now everyone's looking out the window at you talking to this strange girl. Your reputation in the whole neighborhood will be finished." I didn't know anyone in the neighborhood. You know, it's New York City. But anyway, I went upstairs on the elevator and came down with a check for another $5,000. So that made, in today's currency value, $10,000. So I thought that was the end of that. And by the way, she didn't have the books.
That's a lot by any standards. That's a lot by any standards. She must be delighted.
Not over. Not over. 2 weeks later, I was passing through the bus terminal again on my way to visit some friends at Yale University who were in the class behind me. And she saw me. I said, "Oh, no. Oh, no." She said, "Oh, yes. Oh, yes." And again, the same thing happened. To make a long story short, I couldn't talk my way out of it. I guess I had read too many of Prabhupada's books, 4 hours a day for 6 months straight. So again, she escorted me up to my father's apartment after a subway ride. And I came down with a check for, in today's currency value, another $10,000. That made $20,000 altogether. And I had never been to a temple once in my life. So she took that second $10,000 and then told me something which made complete sense. She said, "You've given so much money, you might as well come to the temple and see what it's like." I said, "That's right. I should finally go and see what's going on there." So I did.
And possibly also receive a complimentary copy of Srimad Bhagavatam if they may finally give it to you. I mean, I was intrigued to ask, when did you finally receive the Srimad Bhagavatam, if at all?
I finally got it a month later in December in the mail from the BBT Los Angeles before anyone in the New York Temple had it.
Maharaj, it seems like what was given in the books, you already started to do all of that. Association of devotees, giving generously for Krishna, absorbing yourself in Krishna's thoughts and his words for long periods of the day. If I may have the impudence to ask this, it's on a lighter note. The last chapter, towards the end of the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada gives the reference to the lawyers. So I was just thinking, was this some divine arrangement? In the end, Prabhupada uses some very strong words in the sixth section of the book where he says, the lawyers, they're always cheating. They're coming up with ways to cheat people. When you talked about a will and other things, must I presume that you had something to do with law? Because who else and how else would somebody be talking about a will at 21 years of age?
No, I didn't have anything to do with law study. I was just a New York cosmopolitan word juggler. Yes. I thought I knew everything.
Maharaj, after you joined the society, could you share with us the year and what was the culture in the temples amongst the devotees, their disposition, their attitude towards Srila Prabhupada's books, not just distributing them, but also in terms of assisting in the development of the books and also absorbing themselves on a daily basis in Srila Prabhupada's books?
I can tell you my attitude. I used every spare moment I had to read and read and read. I became a full-time book distributor after being in the temple community for just 3 weeks. And so a full-time book distributor back then meant 7 days a week.
Yes.
And so I never learned how to drive because I figured some other devotee could drive the Sankirtan van and I could read. Yes. Selfish. My greatest delight as a young book distributor was when the word came from the big gun book distributors from the West Coast that Sankirtan devotees should take one day off a week and just read on that day. I said, oh, this is a dream come true. So I would just read from morning to night on that one day a week, as well as a couple of hours on the other days.
So that's very precious, Maharaj. When did this happen? I'm sorry to interrupt you, but this will be very interesting for everyone to know. Which year, when did this happen? What was the history behind this for everybody to take a day to read?
Yes, not everyone, the book distributors.
Yes.
They should have a day off, not to relax physically, but to read the books that we were so dedicated to. So yes, back then the Bhagavatam volumes were much smaller than what you have now. And I could read a newly published volume of Srimad Bhagavatam in one day from morning till night. So you asked,
do you remember the year, Maharaj? Do you remember the year when this happened?
74. 74.
Okay. 74. Wow.
For many devotees, our life and soul was just receiving these newly published volumes and reading them. Not everyone, I have to say, but for many devotees, especially the Sankirtan devotees, the full-time book distributors, this was the life of our life.
Mm-hmm. On that note, Maharaj, you said this was the life of your life, and I'm sure I hope and pray and sure it is even now, because we hear you glorifying Srila Prabhupada's book so affectionately. Maharaj, if you can expand that statement, how can a practicing devotee make Srila Prabhupada's instructions, his books, the life of their life? What does it take? And how does it transform one's spiritual life?
I was always intrigued by Srila Prabhupada's statement that if you want to know him personally, you should read his books, and that reading his books is the best way to be with him. And that was very important for me because I always longed to have Srila Prabhupada's physical association. But here, Srila Prabhupada himself is saying that a better way to be with him than physically is through his books. In fact, I remember once he explained that because we were all in our mind, if not in reality, vying for the chance to have some personal physical service to Srila Prabhupada, and we viewed anyone who was engaged in Srila Prabhupada's personal service, we viewed them as the most fortunate of the fortunate. But then Srila Prabhupada stated something very interesting. He said, if you judge who is an advanced devotee by who is physically closest to me, then I say the mosquito is the best devotee. He said, what is the purpose of the mosquito? It's to bite me. So that got me thinking that maybe I should really value the connection through the books. And indeed, I had more than an opportunity to do that, because to my great neophyte dejection, my health dived in early 1975, and I had to give up the book distribution service, and I wound up with the BBT in Los Angeles, just at the time when Prabhupada was demanding that 17 volumes had to be produced in 2 months.
What a wonderful opportunity, coincidence, divine arrangement. Wow. How was those 2 months, Maharaj, and the journey of the 17 volumes of Chaitanya Charitamrita?
And 2 volumes of Fifth Canto. Yes, it was like stepping into another world, a world that is, even looking back at it, it's materially impossible. And that was the reaction, as you know, of the leaders at that time when Srila Prabhupada demanded all those 17 books in 2 months. They knew, and we still know today, that materially it made no sense. But what could you do? They told Prabhupada, this is impossible. And everyone knows the response. Impossible is the word in the Fool's Dictionary. They came up with a plan. The BBT leaders and GBCs came up with a plan to increase the book publication sixfold. Instead of one volume every 6 months, they were going to give Prabhupada one volume a month. They were so proud. And what did Prabhupada tell them when he heard that? No. All 17 books in 2 months. And he made it clear that his dissatisfaction with us would be present if that goal wasn't met. So it made no sense at all. And you had nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. You couldn't say back then, oh, Prabhupada is really heavy, I'm going to find a Siksha guru. Nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. You couldn't wiggle out unless you wanted to go into Maya. So devotees put their minds on doing the impossible. And it was like an inconceivable energy, and Achincha Shakti descended up, and things started happening. And even to this very day, we can't figure out how it happened. It's like, what would you do if your spiritual master told you, you see that ocean there? Jump in and swim. And you said, but wait, that's dry land. It's an ocean. Jump in and swim. Now, wait a minute. I'm Tapana Mishra. I've got managerial expertise, organizational ability. I mean, really, Gumaraj, all glories to you. Let's be real here. So everything in the material intelligence was rebelling. But out of love for Srila Prabhupada, we decided to walk on what we thought was water, and he was saying is dry land. So that's what I remember extraordinarily, the empowerment that descended. And then when the miracle was accomplished, I remember Srila Prabhupada's detachment. One devotee flew from the US with the last printed volume, because at that time, the books were printed in the USA and Prabhupada was in Vrindavan for his Vyasa Puja ceremony. And Vyasa Puja day was his deadline. And so triumphantly, the devotee flew from the USA to Delhi and got a taxi to Vrindavan and walked into the Krishna Balaram Mandir as Prabhupada was getting off the Vyasasan at the conclusion of the Vyasa Puja ceremony. The devotee followed Prabhupada back to his quarters, and Prabhupada sat down in his room, and the devotee came in and paid full dandavats triumphantly, presented Prabhupada the book. Like, Prabhupada, we've done it. We've done it. We fulfilled your desire. And Prabhupada just calmly looked at the book, looked at him and said, oh, you have promised before the ceremony and now it is after. And then later that night, he wrote the famous letter to the BBT staff that by this effort, you will all go back to Godhead.
So purifying, Maharaj, just to hear it. Just to hear it. I believe we'll have to wait for another kalpa. Is that what it is? Another day, if at all, to experience this. But just hearing from you for those few minutes, we could feel it. Thank you so much. Thank you so very much for sharing this. Maharaj, in those years, those 5 years, 70, the first back to God at 72, teachings of Prahlad Maharaj, you were a reader, you were reading Prabhupada's books, then you were distributing Prabhupada's books, and then you also helped, assisted in the service of printing Prabhupada's books. You possibly covered all three posts. Bases on that front of how one could engage. And of course, after that, you've been engaged in helping all of us, in sharing with us what you've read throughout your life from Srila Prabhupada's books. We are sometimes approached by devotees with several questions. One question is, we have so many other books to read. Why is it necessary to read Prabhupada's books? Another way to put it is, sometimes devotees say, hey, you know, they're told you need to read other books before you read Prabhupada's books. What would your response be if somebody was to approach you with that sort of a proposal, Maharaj?
I like to point out, using a restaurant example, you have the main meal and then you have the side dishes. There's no reason why you can't have side dishes, but you should always know what the main meal is. Without the main meal, you're missing out on what is the main nourishment.
Thank you.
Who am I to say to someone they can't read my godbrother's books? But at the same time, I feel I'm duty bound to point out what is the main course, the main meal. And if I see that a devotee is lost in the side dishes, which are beneficial, of course, but is neglecting the main meal, then I feel obligated to say something.
Thank you. Such a beautiful analogy, Maharaj. Makes the point very clear in our head. The next question that often comes, moving from practicing devotees to managers, leaders, very busy, so many services, so many things to accomplish for Srila Prabhupada. Where is the time to read? Perhaps later on, or maybe my service right now is much more important than reading Prabhupada's books. Have you come across such devotees, Maharaj, and especially in leaders and managerial realm? What really happens to their lives? How do they sustain? Could you please share with us some examples of what really happens?
Unfortunately, such devotees don't last for a long time. The foundation of all our services is hearing and chanting. And again, we need to hear that hearing Krishna Katha, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita dissolves our material desires. This is so mystical that I think our own devotees often don't really take it on board. Hearing about Krishna, hearing Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita destroys our material desires. There's passionate ignorance, which is so prevalent in the age of Kali. What happens is that hearing Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam overpowers the mode of passion and ignorance, and gradually you become established in the mode of goodness from which you can easily step beyond, out of the modes completely. So officially, anyone who fully takes up the bhakti process officially is in the mode of goodness, but the passionate ignorance can still be a raging influence, but officially the devotee is in the mode of goodness. In order to dissolve or dissipate that passionate ignorance completely, one has to be very dedicated to hear and chant. And that's why we can never minimize the value of reading. And Srila Prabhupada's books, especially, I will say from my own experience, his books have the 100% cooperation of the super soul in the heart. It's teamwork when you read Prabhupada's books. Because of his unique status as founder Acharya and as an extraordinary devotee of the Lord, because of that special status, his books have a special cooperation of the super soul. So you're getting that full teamwork between Prabhupada, the Lord's dear devotee, and the super soul in the heart. And that's why Prabhupada's books can be so beguiling or so puzzling sometimes. Why? What's here? Why are we so attracted to them? They're spoken in simple language. They repeat points over and over again. Materially, you could dissect them with a critical mind. But then again, there's something mysterious going on. Shinvatam Sakata Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana.
Yes, and Maharaj, this perspective that you shared with us is very helpful for us. You use the phrase that the Paramatma is acting. Because often we sometimes hear, actually not often, sometimes we hear the statement that the books are alive. Srila Prabhupada is personally present, guiding through his books, the books are alive. But this, just one phrase that you use, the Paramatma's presence actually helps us now understand how they're alive and how they guide us. Maharaj, you said 6 months, 4 hours, you're reading again and again and again. Devotees sometimes approach with this statement. They say that, we've already read Bhagavad Gita. We've already read Srimad Bhagavatam. Actually, most of them, no, they don't say that. They said, we've already read those small books and other books. This inertia, lethargy, or this thought that we already know, we don't need to read. Maharaj, what is the cause and how to overcome this? because you're giving a very different experience of relishing it again and again versus others who say, I've gone through it. I know what it is.
The more you engage in selfless devotional service, the more the super soul allows you to see what's going on in Prabhupada's books. He explained to us in Los Angeles in 1976 that his books contain everything in them for the most neophyte to the most advanced devotee. He compared his books to a pharmacy, or what's called in some countries a chemist, which has medicines, pharmaceuticals for all types of patients. So he said his books are like that. They help the neophyte, and they even help the most advanced devotee. As we engage in surrendered devotional service more, the super soul in the heart helps us to avoid that mistake you described of thinking you know it all, you've seen it all, you've heard it all, it's the same old, same old. The super soul, as Srimad Bhagavatam says itself, the super soul in the heart empowers you to see the spiritual reality that everything about bhakti is ever fresh, increasingly fresh. So we don't want to be deprived of our luxuries because of a familiar attitude, materially familiar, mundane attitude. Oh, I read this before. You want to go deeper and deeper in realization. And therefore, you can read Bhagavad Gita again and again and again. And each time, it's a deeper experience. So my advice is that when you start to have those feelings that I've heard this before, I've read this before, I need something new, realize that that's a material tendency and double down on your efforts to tune in to Srila Prabhupada through his books, and you'll be in store for an amazing transformational experience.
Maharaj, it's that transformational experience for which we are coming to this moment. We want to be part of this, to just receive that mercy, receive that contact, communion with the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the Parampara. And you mentioned two things. You said, double down, and previously also mentioned, Maharaj, that try to engage in pure devotional service, in selfless service. Maharaj, many practicing devotees now are householders working outside, we call them congregation, different phrases in different parts of the world I use, busy lives. What can you say to inspire them that, yes, besides the vows one has taken, how to inspire them to actually be able to taste the nectar that you just described?
Well, first of all, we all want to be free from the harassment of material desires. And without regular hearing, that's not going to happen. Religious belief is not going to get us far. Oh, well, I believe in Krishna. That's enough. I've got my spiritual name. I'm wearing neck beads. When I see another devotee, I say Hari Bol. That's nice, but if you really want to get to the root of our problem, which is material desires, there must be a regular program of hearing. So somehow or other, we have to build our life around that, no matter what ashram we're in. Householders are busy, sannyasis are busy, brahmacharis are busy, everyone's busy. And everyone can come up with their excuses. I can start. Up until COVID, it was just every other day was another airport. Dealing with airlines is such a pain in the neck. There's nothing glorious about nonstop flying, traveling here, traveling there. you have to deal with your health and so many complications. And so everyone is busy. And of course, we know that household life has its busyness without a doubt. Job, spouse, often their children. So many material arrangements have to be dealt with. But without a solid program of hearing and chanting at the core, gradually, as Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur explains, you lose the ability to discriminate between material affairs and spiritual affairs. It all becomes one blur.
Maharaj, could you unpack this statement a little bit for us, please, with some example?
We need the association of devotees. Why? Because in the association of devotees, there is hearing and chanting about Krishna. And as Lord Kapila Dev explains in the third canto, Satam Prasangan Mama Virya Samvido, Bhavanti Hrit Karna Rasayana Kata. The talks about Krishna become even more powerful and sweet when recited in the Sangha, the association of sincere devotees. So we need devotees for hearing and chanting. And without that Sangha, that association of comrades for hearing and chanting, whether it's friends, our own family members, or a congregation, or Bhakti Vriksha, or Bhakti Center, or whatever, we need camaraderie, birds of a feather flock together. Without that, we become weak in our own hearing and chanting, and then gradually, we don't see a distinction anymore between material activities and spiritual activities. It all becomes a blur. Well, everything in my life is kind of spiritual, you know, even though we're doing activities in which Krishna is not the enjoyer.
But and in sometimes, Maharaj, years and decades can pass with that blurry life.
Yes.
Before somebody reminds us again, like you're doing it now.
Yes. So this is the challenge for all of us. And we need to remind one another of this. We lose track very easily in this day and age. I'm sure you've noticed that we can get off the rails very quickly, amazingly so. There's so many mass weapons of distraction out to get us. So you have to be a bit militant about your hearing and chanting program. Mm-hmm.
Yes, Maharaj. Hearing from you, we understand that reading Prabhupada's books, association with Prabhupada's books is right at the center of the hearing and chanting program.
Yes, because we want to know this extraordinary devotee. And he's ordered us to read his books. So we're disciples, grand disciples, we're in his line. We're ordered to read them.
Maharaj, on this note, for several years, in the recent few years, there's been emphasis. We at least talk about Srila Prabhupada being the founder acharya. And some of us are imbibing it in our spirit. The others could be just not doing that much in plain English, doing lip service. This aspect, which you've kindly spoken to us today about reading Prabhupada's books and its relationship to Srila Prabhupada being the founder acharya, could you say a few words of how these two come together, if at all? Also the phrase, preeminent Siksha Guru, the phrase, you know, I'm sorry, this phrase also comes up.
Which phrase?
Srila Prabhupada as the preeminent Siksha Guru for ISKCON.
If he is the preeminent Siksha Guru, that means that we should all cherish his books so that we can have personal realization of Srila Prabhupada's core foundational role in our life. Otherwise, it will indeed just be lip service. And lip service is better than nothing, but it doesn't get you very far. Let's be factual. There are always going to be lip service devotees, and we hope that we'll all make spiritual advancement beyond that phase. So we don't want to drive anyone away. Oh, you're just doing lip service. Get out of here. No, we want to encourage everyone to make further progress. But if you want to get to the heart of Srila Prabhupada's movement, then we must cherish his books, love reading them, love distributing them. That's my personal motto. Love to read them, love to distribute them. And then you'll see Mahaprabhu's mercy come alive for you.
Well, kabe habe bolo sedin amar Maharaj, we're waiting. Now you've given us some light that there is a possibility. So we'll definitely try to apply this in our lives on a regular basis. Maharaj, may I ask you, you've been sincerely reading and accepting Srila Prabhupada's instructions through the books. How should, when one takes Srila Prabhupada's books, what are the things that one must avoid? And what are the things one must do? What preparation of the mind, of the body, one must have when one picks up Srila Prabhupada's books so that one can get the maximum mercy of Srila Prabhupada's instructions?
Sanatana Goswami writes in Krishna Lila Stava that every syllable of Srimad Bhagavatam is saturated with Krishna Prem. So when you read Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, know that every syllable is emanating Krishna Prem, and we want to get to the point of perceiving that more and more. First, we will experience our heart being cleansed. When you feel overrun by material desires, which is normal in this age of Kali, you'll be shocked what happens if you just pull out one of Prabhupada's books and start reading and reading, and you feel that you've just taken a spiritual shower, and that gives you realization. There is hope for me. I just have to purify my heart by reading these books, and especially if you're able to read them with other devotees, whether your own family, friends, Bhakti Riksha, Bhakti Lounge, Bhakti Center, so on and so forth, you'll catch the virus. It's highly contagious, but it's very symptomatic. And you can help spread that virus to others. So I pray that we all can have this infection. That the first step is seeing how reading those books purifies the core of our heart. And then secondly, we start to see things in the books that we thought we had read before, and they assume a new light for us. And gradually we'll start to see these books igniting the development of our love for Krishna. This is our life. This is our career of corporate advancement.
I'm reminded, Maharaj, of a statement from the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj, where Prabhupada said, this this process and Krishna, one may not be able to see with the eyes, but by practicing, one can perceive it. And you taught us today how to sharpen our perception to be able to perceive. Maharaj, is there some things, you know, for coming from somebody like you who possibly receives the books with such grace, but is there something, some caution, some warning, something that you want to share with all of us that, hey, don't do this with the books when you're approaching the books, something that could actually become a major obstacle to us from going forward in the path that you just described?
Don't think that you've heard it all before. Don't think all these books are written in simple language and the concepts are repeated very often. You're not simply reading for informational content. You're reading for contact with Krishna through the parampara. Prabhupada's books are not like a catalog full of information, details. They're more than informational. They are transformational. They're giving us direct contact through the parampara with Krishna, through Krishna's pure devotees. So don't listen when our mind and senses tell us, oh, I've read this so many times. This is all elementary. I know it all. I need to hear something new. Don't let that fool you. Beg Srila Prabhupada, beg Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that we can penetrate deeper into our reading, into our hearing, past these superficial conceptions of that's the same old, same old. There must be a reason. Think, there must be a reason why Prabhupada is repeating these points. Obviously, I don't get it. Look at my life. I haven't assimilated it all. Where's the transformation that I need? Obviously, I have to focus more on what I'm reading, what I'm hearing. And while I'm focusing more on reading, I am begging for the ability to apply what I'm reading, and then there'll be transformation.
Maharaj, what could be some of the symptoms that one would notice?
Every time you pick up a book, one of Prabhupada's books to read, you're so happy. Oh, happy day. Just picking up a book and now I can read. Oh, this is wonderful.
Maharaj, thank you so much for sharing with us the world, which of course is open in front of you, but also giving us a glimpse of what it is to live a life which started off at least with the contact of Srila Prabhupada's instruction, how it is a joyful, happy life to be in touch with Krishna through Srila Prabhupada's books. Maharaj, any parting message that you like to give while we bring our discussion today to a close to all of us?
Yes. My mantra, love to read them, love to distribute them. Distribute means this way, that way, whatever way, that's fine, but let's do it. Let's love to read Prabhupada's books and let's love to distribute them.
And Maharaj, we love to hear from you again and again on this topic. Thank you so very much for inspiring us, for sharing with us and guiding us and leaving not one motto, but many valuable thoughts that we must ponder upon. And I believe the best thing that we all can do in return is to pick up Srila Prabhupada's books and start reading them every day. Thank you, Maharaj.
I thank you for this wonderful service you're doing, and I'm really impressed by your determination to execute this service.
Maharaj, with your encouragement, and I'm sure with what we have heard today, I'm good to go for several more weeks. And with your permission, I may ask this now publicly, if I feel low and if the material modes, as you described, start taking over me, would you be so kind to give me another opportunity to hear from you? Because truly and honestly from my heart, I say this, I feel enlivened to read and to do my service. And I beg you for another opportunity to hear from you again.
I thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and all glories to Srila Prabhupada's transcendental books. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.